You know, one of the main aspects of a shift in your attention, in your consciousness, is the transition between diversity into oneness. And many times what is happening when we're searching is that we are fixed in a state of mind that is seeing diversity. It's seeing separate, including you. It's only a state of mind. That's why, because you see yourself separate, then you create identity individually in each object you observe. So because you are alone, or you are an individual in the form of your body, then that lamp is alone and is an individual, and that fire is alone and is an individual, and each of those flowers, they are alone and they are individuals, because that's the modality of your mind, you understand? It shifts into oneness when that individuality vanishes. So for that individuality to vanish, needs to first vanish or in the self that is observing it, in the individual, or in the object of perception. So one exercise in meditation, you can say, is to bring down, to bring back objects to its origin. So you basically dismantle them from there. You take away their identity. You peel it, like if you peel the skin of a fruit, and you try to go to the core of that object. And then you, as you take layer by layer, you start entering oneness. If you can't do that, because that requires concentration, you can do the same with you. So then you can investigate, who am I? And you can say, well, I am so-and-so, and I was born here, and I had this life. And then you realize that what we normally call I is a story, is something that what happened, not to who it happened. I mean, if we are really honest, when somebody asks us, who are you, we shouldn't be saying what happened to us. No? It happens a lot in the street. Sometimes you ask people, how are you? You ask a friend, how are you? And they go, well, you know, I've done this and my office is so, and it's been so busy, but I can't wait for the holiday. But he's not answering. He's not answering about how he or she is. He's answering what is happening to him. He's not answering. So, but that's not because he's hiding. It's because he's confused. His identity is related to what is happening. He doesn't know that he is not what is happening. He hasn't drawn a line between who they are and what is happening. It's all mixed up. What's happening is who I am. So when you start investigating into your own, yes, you shift from the individuality, which is what happened to you, which creates an individual existence to whom all those things happened, they're linked. All what happened as a residue creates an entity that to who that happens, yeah? Or happened, yeah? So that in itself you call I, and that's not who you are. You still are the one, you see? That is talking about what happened. And in the best scenario can talk about who, to who that happened. But not about you. When you talk about you, when you come back eventually to you, then the individuality in you vanished. And when you look outside from that new state of mind, then the diversity of objects vanished, then you see oneness. Then you see a lamp pretending to be a lamp. And you see, you understand? And you see the fire pretending to be the fire. You see the stove pretending to be a stove, quite uncomfortably, actually, that stove. It's obviously very, or clearly not a stove, but it's doing its best. And so on. That bull lamp there kind of hanging around, you know? It's not a lamp. It's some natural fiber put into a frame, creating the illusion of space between light and shadow. And so on. So you see oneness when you don't separate individually each object. Now, when you are in that state, you don't say to yourself, oh, I see oneness.
No.
You understand?
I really felt it when Victor said something. Mm. With oneness.
Mm.
I felt it really strongly in me. That's why.
Yes, beautiful.
But it doesn't last long. I mean, I don't know that it doesn't last long. When you're talking about all of this, it seems like when you talk about it, it seems like it happens all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't.
Well, it doesn't belong to the happening world.
Yeah, but you perceive that way.
Exactly.
Constantly.
So now, if you look inside of you,
mm-hmm.
can you find that oneness?
Mm.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
So it hasn't vanished.
Yeah. No, but I... No.
No.
I guess I don't, you know.
Hmm? Yes, can say it.
No, I mean, right now I can say I feel that, but I still see diversity.
Yeah, of course, because the mind that is saying I can see that,
yeah,
is already calling that you.
Yeah.
So then in that state is diversity.
Yeah.
So when you know, imagine we are on the road, okay? This is a road here, and the buildings here are blue, and the buildings in front are green, okay? So, when you look inside, and you are in the blue side, yes? You see the blue, okay? Now, when you look outside, you see green. So the blue is gone. The blue is gone, it was blue, and it was there, but who's talking is the blue. The blue is saying, there is only green, but that's because the blue is looking that way.
Yeah.
If the blue would look back in, would see blue again. But when it talks outside, when the mind goes externally, it goes directly into the modality of diversity.
Yeah, okay?
Okay? So that comes in a form of, yes, but I am not aware of that, and whatever. Okay?
Yeah.
It's talking green.
Yeah.
You understand? So then you have to understand that process. You have to become familiar with the fact that the mind does that. So in that way, it stops tricking you.
Yeah.
You understand? Yeah. Because when it complains about something, you silently can prove it wrong. When the mind says, it's only green, everything is green, you internally know you're blue. Mm. You understand?
Yeah. I guess my question following on from this is, kind of a desire to go, yeah. Just to deepen kind of in oneness, if you know
yes.
what I mean. Because you said earlier, people talk about oneness and it's just a kind of a... I have, you know, years and years ago talked about oneness being a kind of a theory, but
mm-hmm.
sometimes I really do feel it. Yeah. But no, I kind of would like to feel it more.
And who's talking?
Yes.
Who's talking about it? Who's talking about wanting to feel it?
Mm? Yeah, okay.
You just said you understood.
Yeah, I do. Well,
you said you understood, and I said, so it doesn't trick you again. And you say, yes, it's true, okay, but I want to feel it more.
Okay. Enough said.
You see?
Yeah. It's just so beautiful when... It's just so beautiful, that's all.
It is so beautiful when you can see from clarity, because you can see your mind saying, I want to feel it all, and you are actually what the mind is trying to feel. So you are having it all, and the mind is just trying to feel it. You are it, and the mind is trying to feel it.
Yeah. So, yeah, when you were saying hold on, you said earlier, hold on, that's what I mean.
Hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Hmm. Yes, when I say hold on, it's so beautiful because then you see all the, you know, how many circles the dog goes through before it sits down. Have you seen that? I just go like... Sometimes it takes them ages. And you can, from stillness, you can see your mind going like... Rick, 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 and eventually... sat down. In my culture, we have very obviously folkloric wisdom, and we have our own literature, and there are many beautiful sayings. One of them that I like very much is something that says, "Do not clarify that it becomes darker." When people say, let me clarify. No, no. Do not clarify because it becomes darker. No aclare que oscurece. We say in my country. No aclare que oscurece. Well, I wish you are all feeling the bliss of your own self. Even if it's for a moment or for a second, because that will change your attitude in life. You will look for it already much more aware of. When I say it, you see? When I speak, I don't escape. You see? I don't escape the imposition of the mind creating the illusion of diversity. It's the law of nature. Language exists in diversity. So that's why you can't mention the unmentionable. The moment you mention it, you create a different image. So you're all, and we're all bound to language with those particular law of nature. Language is limited. So then you have to understand that, so you don't try to say the unmentionable to begin with. Yes? Because you won't manage. You won't be the first one. And also, particularly, you don't succumb to language or to the thoughts that you may have through language that make you feel that things are in a particular way, that is only an illusion in the phenomenality of things. Peace is not found in the phenomenality of things. It is found beyond the phenomena. It's found in the unmanifest first. And then it spreads its wings into the manifestation. But first in the unmanifest. And the unmanifest has no language, contains no language, is not the world of the manifest. The world of the manifest has a law in itself. So these things you need to understand very clearly, so you don't get disturbed by language, or you don't get confused by words, or you don't believe that the essential has to be understood in a graphical, manifested way. The essential has to be felt. Yes? Tell me.
I just wanted to say, I had a very strong feeling of this oneness from the way you talked yesterday about you speaking to things, this oneness was very strong, and I went for a walk and I really felt it, and I felt it with people who I just never seen before, and that really I really love that. I just wanted to say that. Okay. It was strong for me.
Yes.
And sometimes I feel a little bit like I talk to trees or something. I feel I have a little experience of it.
Yes,
myself. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Everyone can be your best friend. Anything else? Yes, sir?
You just explain that. Everyone can be your best friend.
What bit?
How can everyone be your best friend? Are you talking love, how you feel about them? How you would feel about your best friend?
How
you would feel about your best friend? They'd be your best friend. Are you saying you can feel about everybody like that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I mean, I say that everybody could be your best friend. Everyone.
Yes, you did say that. Okay. Okay. Sorry.
Yes?
Yep. It's quite something though, isn't it?
Is it?
Yeah. That's wonderful. Okay, I think I've got it. What did I just say?
It's wonderful, you say. I don't know if you're teasing me or... yes,
no,
well...
I don't know, I meant that, sure.
Well, do you understand then what I mean? No, but it's wonderful.
To feel about everyone as if they were your best friend. Yeah. That's special, isn't it?
Yes, I suppose. I mean, when I say that, I say it in different ways too. I mean, I say that if you look at anyone, anyone you meet, anybody you even if you don't meet them, if you just see a person, you can actually feel that they can be your best friend. So you have the aspect of potentially, if you get to know them, they can become your best friend. Or you can also, if you look carefully, you can have the same love that you can have for a best friend without knowing them, without changing words. There is something, there is a connection that can be, you know, revealed if you look carefully. It's a recognition.
Which is why I was maybe remembering sometimes, particularly in St. Ives, people will say hello.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes the smile and the words and the acknowledgement, you know that there's the potential there for them to be your best friend.
Yes, yes, yes.
Others will, you know, and sometimes you will look the other way or look to see if the train's coming or something like that, you know. But you're saying even there would be the potential.
Oh, yeah.